On This Week in Enterprise Tech, Apple and Google team up, microwaves are the future of the internet, and Allyn Malventano drops by to show you some SSD myths. Quiet on the set.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for This Week in Enterprise Tech is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This is Twit. This Week in Enterprise Tech, episode 141. Recorded May 22nd, 2015. SSD Myths with Allyn Malventano. This Week in Enterprise Tech is brought to you by Braintree. If you're working on a mobile app and searching for the right payments API, check out the Braintree V.0 SDK. With one simple integration, you get every way to pay. To learn more and to try out the sandbox, go to braintreepayments.com/enterprise. And by ZipRecruiter. Are you hiring? With ZipRecruiter.com, you can post to 100-plus job sites, including social networks, all with a single click. Screen, rate, and hire the right candidates fast. Try ZipRecruiter with a free 4-day trial now at ZipRecruiter.com/Twiat. Welcome to Twiat This Week in Enterprise Tech. It's the show dedicated to the enterprise professional, the IT pro, and the geek who just wants to know how the world is connected. I'm your host, Father Robert Ballecer, the digital Jesuit, your guide to all things in the enterprise. And I'm joined by my cast of cohorts, starting with Mr. Brian Chee, the director of the Advanced Network Computing Laboratory in Honolulu, Hawaii. Chiebert, how are you doing, friend? I mean, you finished up your mini maker. You look a little tired. What's going on in paradise?
I am finishing writing the checks to pay for mini maker.
That's always fun. Yeah.
Yeah. But big shout out to the members of the Honolulu Drone Club who are really looking forward to meeting you when you're in Hawaii. And it looks like they are going to help me run the drone portion of the Mini Maker Fair next year.
Ooh, fantastic. It's always good to have friends. Speaking of friends, our friends over on the right coast, Mr. Curtis Franklin from Information Week Radio. Curtis, how are you, my friend?
Doing quite well, Padre. Just happy to be here to get my holiday weekend kicked off right.
That's right. This is a long weekend for those people in the United States. So bear with us if we are a little loopy. Most of us have departed in our minds already. Let's go ahead and kick it off with some blips. And the first one is more hacks. Yay! This week it was disclosed that the net USB kernel from Taiwan-based KC Code suffers from a buffer overflow vulnerability categorized as CVE-2015-3036 that can be exploited for remote code execution. The vulnerability is triggered when a client supplies a name that is longer than 64 characters. The driver is used to allow the use of USB devices over a network and is likely used in firmware from vendors including Netgear, D-Link, TP-Link, TrendNet, Zyxel, IoGear, Level 1, Longshine, PCI Ingenious, Encore, Edimax, Asante, Atlantis, Amit, Ambeer, AllNet, Western Digital, and several others. While the attack is most easily triggered by a client on the LAN itself, devices that expose TCP port 20005 on the WAN are vulnerable to attack from the internet.
Android, iOS, Windows, and PayPal? Well, later this year, PayPal will spin off as a public company separate from eBay, which acquired the payment company in 2002. The spinoff occurs as PayPal faces increased competition in the mobile payment space, but PayPal is still the leader and intends to stay out front. Dan Schulman, PayPal president and the CEO designate of the new company, recently said that PayPal has embraced service-oriented architecture and agile development so that changes take hours, new feature releases come every 2 weeks, and each element of the platform has an associated API and SDK. PayPal is trying to reimagine itself as something more than a payment platform. As one of the slides in Schulman's presentation declared, PayPal's next chapter is as, quote, the operating system for digital commerce, end quote. Now, what does that mean? It's a payment platform, a payment gateway, a payment processor, a digital wallet, a credit provider, and a source of financial data with more to come. Looks like the fees for credit card transactions just aren't paying the bills and won't anymore.
Well, the European Union president is looking to dump net neutrality. In a move that pundits say is a move to force mobile roaming, a leaked document seems to indicate the EU is considering dumping adoption of net neutrality. It should be stressed that this non-paper document is from the EU's president's office, currently held by Latvia, and seems to go against the European Parliament's option that neutrality should be put into law. Who knows what's going to happen as the EU struggles with some member states nearly bankrupt while also trying to set communications policy for the next decade.
The Silicon Valley and big IT in general have been trying to shake the bro-bro all-boys club image since, well, forever. The emergence of female executives and engineers in IT, along with some big name conferences banning booth babes, have been an encouraging trend, but of course, two steps forward and then FortaCloud back. This week, Western Virginia cloud computing outfit FortaCloud posted a special 50% off Monday coupon on their Twitter account with the image of a female who was not engaged in cloud computing. When called out by their followers, FortaCloud's social media rep responded, "Well, 99% of our customers are male, and GoDaddy did it too. Keep it classy, cloud computing."
It's time to start hoarding those IPv4 addresses. It's like the internet service that cried wolf, but this time it's for real. The American Registry for Internet Numbers, or ARIN, says we truly will run out of IPv4 addresses in North America this summer. That's when ARIN expects to no longer be able to fulfill requests for IPv4 addresses and will activate its waiting list for unmet IPv4 requests. Now, there's a total of about 4.3 billion IPv4 addresses available, but many are reserved. According to John Curran, president and CEO of ARIN, the registry is down to its last 3.25 million IPv4 addresses. ARIN is one of five regional internet registries that dole out IPv4 addresses and one of the last to hit the bottom of its address pool. If you go on the waiting list, what can you do? The good news is that you have options. You can consider deploying IPv6, the new internet protocol that offers IP addresses galore, or look to the IPv4 transfer market and buy IPv4 addresses from parties that don't need them anymore. In any case, if you've been putting off that IPv6 training, well, consider this that sign you've been waiting for.
Well, the iHeartRadio cops to a mega mea culpa and pays a mega buck to the FCC for a cascade of false emergency announcements. Seems iHeart's radio station in Nashville accidentally kicked off a multi-state cascade of false emergency announcements that cascaded across hundreds of radio stations because software systems did not check the date-time headers of the message. The FCC is freaking out because such false alerts can potentially degrade the public's trust in the emergency announcement system and was totally preventable.
Now, 2 weeks ago, we talked about the rise of browser-based DDoS attacks as DNS and NTP servers are hardened against amplification attacks. Last week, we also talked about the Edge router vulnerability that allowed those devices to become a DDoS botnet. This week, it's all about your peripherals. Researchers at Akamai have discovered that attackers are exploiting the SSD plug-and-play protocols in network peripherals to SYNFlood servers. Though the peripherals have a fraction of the available bandwidth of a PC or router, the sheer number of such devices makes them a potent exploit in the first quarter of 2015. SYNFlood attacks accounted for 17% of all attacks in the data center in that time. What makes this trend infuriating is the fact that the simple service discovery protocol shouldn't be internet-facing, but there are a huge number of consumer routers that are just, well, junk. Once again, who needs the core if you can own the edge? Now, when we come back, we're going to go ahead and jump into some of the enterprise bites. But before we do that, let's go ahead and take a moment to thank the first sponsor of this episode of This Week in Enterprise Tech. Now, let me have a little conversation with you devs out there, because I know you're long-suffering. Let me guess, you're trying to integrate financial payment information on your website, on your app, on your service. And now, for most of us, that's just a pain, because you have to worry about security. You have to worry about proper integration. You have to worry about not exposing your company to any sort of liability on the back end. Well, you could go through all that trouble, or you could just go with Braintree, which is why we welcome them to the Twiat Riot. Now, the Braintree V.0 SDK makes it easy to offer multiple mobile payment types. You add 10 lines of code, just 10 lines of code, and you can start securely accepting PayPal, Apple Pay, Bitcoin, Venmo, and more, all with a single integration. Now, not only can you integrate Braintree into your solution in minutes with just those 10 lines of code, but they have engineers on call to walk you through the integration. No muss, no fuss, no sweat, and no hassle. Now, if you are one of those developers worrying about how Braintree will work with your solution, just don't. Braintree has SDKs in 7 languages: .NET, Node.js, Java, Perl, PHP, Python, Ruby, and it supports Android, iOS, and JavaScript clients. Best of all, they've documented everything, so there's nothing left to chance. This is not a fly-by-wire company that's just going to just leave you in the lurch. They're not just going to give you a solution that you don't know whether or not it's secure. They back everything up. They offer you a sandbox so you can test it and make sure that it works before you actually put it into production. Now, if you want a complicated way to accept payments, one that might not be secure, one that will cause you no end of trouble, then by all means, don't use Braintree. But if you want an easy way to accept multiple payment types with one integration, quick, knowledgeable developer support, and the ability to accept payments all in one popular form, then you need to set yourself up in less than 10 minutes with the Braintree V.0 SDK. To learn more, and for your first $50,000 in transactions fee-free, go to BraintreePayments.com/enterprise. That's BraintreePayments.com/enterprise. And we thank Braintree for their support of this week in Enterprise Tech. Gentlemen, let's go ahead and jump into the Enterprise Bites. This first one, we've kind of been following it for a while, and I would love to get some of your input on how this is developing. Now, more than 2 years ago, towards the start of our run here on the Twit TV network, Twit covered the story of financial firms and investment bankers who were building out their own networks in order to take advantage of reduced network latency. They figured that if they could shave a millisecond, half of a millisecond off of a round trip for a packet, that they could effectively know the future of the financial markets before the financial markets actually knew it. Now, to that end, you had a massive outlay in private transatlantic fiber and a renewed interest in microwave towers. Now, at the end of 2012, a few high-frequency trading firms, known as flash traders, set up microwave links between New York and Chicago. They did this because fiber, believe it or not, actually slows down light. Light will travel through fiber in the clearest glass, that's the highest quality glass with the least amount of obstructions, at about 200,000 kilometers per second. But light, in the form of an electromagnetic wave, will travel through the air at slightly less than the 300,000 kilometers per second that you would get in a vacuum. Now, that means that information will travel from New York to Chicago through a dedicated fiber link in about 10.5 milliseconds. However, with current microwave tech, it does it in 8.5. So it shaves off between 1.5 and 2 milliseconds of time. And for a flash trader, that's as good as a crystal ball. Chiebert, let me throw this over to you first. We have been covering this story. Have you seen a lot more market for this? Because it seems like everyone wants it now because it's become the standard to have your own link.
Yeah. Who knows? I don't deal with those kind of people. I think they're evil, but that's all right. you know, the funny part is both Kurt and I both did a bypass wireless test where we kind of measured the, you know, speed of microwave links versus laser links versus, you know, Wi-Fi type links. And they're, you know, when you have really, really accurate clocks, you're actually measuring the speed of light. And yeah, just using, you know, standard physics, it's not really sexy. Yeah, if you're trying to travel through a medium that's thicker than air, meaning glass, yes, it's going to go slower. So I don't see why this wouldn't work. I haven't seen it yet because I'm not involved in that segment, but it makes sense.
Right.
You know, if you've got enough money.
One of the things here to consider is also that if you're running fiber between New York and Chicago, you're actually doing multiple hops, more hops than you would have to do if you were relaying microwave signals, because every time you get to a repeater or every time you get to a switch, you're actually going to be adding latency. The numbers that they gave were assuming that you could get a direct link between New York and Chicago, which you often can't. Unless you own the fiber, unless you actually laid the fiber or you've contracted with a company that has that fiber, you're going to be doing a couple of hops, which actually increases the advantage. And when you're dealing with flash traders, they only need half a millisecond in order to make bank off of this. Curtis, let me throw this over to you. This is something that we've also seen in fiber being laid across the Atlantic. They were using it in transaction with London markets so that they could get, again, that millisecond or two where they could trade against what they already knew what was going to happen. This has become big business, right?
Oh, it absolutely has. And let's remember, it's more than just the difference between transmission through open space and transmission through a glass cable. By and large, those glass cables have to a certain extent, follow the terrain. That means they curve to go under rivers. They curve to go around lakes. Whereas the microwave shots are straight. And so all of those curves start to add in as well. And by the time you get through with all this adds up, and suddenly you're talking about just not 1 or 2 milliseconds, but tens of milliseconds, which in the world of program trading is an eternity. We're talking about financial markets that deal in the smallest of fractions. We recently had a multi-billion dollar set of fines levied against banks for rigging currency, where when you get down to it, they were taking advantage of fractions of a fraction of a difference between the price of one currency and another. When you are doing it in large enough quantity, those fractions add up. And so what we have is yet another way that the very biggest player can build in some more advantage for themselves. It's the kind of thing that's been going on for a couple hundred years at least. And, well, to coin a phrase, it shows no sign of slowing down.
You know, the funny thing is, we actually covered this on Know How a few weeks back. The towers that time forgot. It was a story that Wired had run about, and I think all three of us will remember these. Do you remember those huge microwave towers that they had built all across the United States to relay microwave links and from one place to another? And back then, this was state of the art. Now, most of these towers have crumbled to dust. They've become nothing, or they've been repurposed for like cellular towers and research stations. But this kind of technology is actually making a comeback. How strange is that, Chiebert? Then a technology we thought was dead 60 years ago is suddenly it's everyone wants it because you can have your own dedicated link now.
Well, yeah, and we'll see. One of the reasons why those microwave towers have also fallen out of favor is they are bloody dangerous.
Yeah.
I actually worked with a gentleman that had a prosthetic arm, and he lost it because there was a crack in a microwave feed horn, and he just ran his hand across the feed horn, and that crack let out enough microwave radiation that it cooked his arm.
Yeah. Actually, we've got JJ to the 4884 in the chat room who's saying, does this microwave transmission affect health devices like normal microwaves in your house? No, this is thousands, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of times more stronger than the signals you would be getting out of your microwave. FYI. So, yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, JJ to the four whatevers. Yeah, these things are really dangerous. And that's why you'll find them in very isolated areas. And they are quite a bit above human population. That's why all these pictures have them on top of ridges and mountains.
Yeah. No, you wouldn't want to put these anywhere near actual people because a concentrated microwave signal is, well, it cooks things like birds and arms. Now, let me throw this over to Curtis. Speaking of these microwave towers, there is something else that's developing, and this is a story that I really want to talk about. Some researchers at the University of Illinois and Duke University want to move microwave tech away from that niche market of ultra-fast flash trading more into the service of folks on the internet. Now, here's what they figure. Microwave can get you ultra-low latency, but the bandwidth is not great. This is why those towers that we were just talking about died out, because even though they could give you really fast links, you could not transmit that much data over them. There was a big limitation. Fiber gives you a ton of bandwidth. You can push a lot of data through it, but of course, it's going to be slower than microwave. So what these researchers are coming up with is a system that hybrids the two. The ability to transfer data that is incredibly time sensitive over microwave, and then transfer the data that requires a lot of bandwidth but isn't as time sensitive over fiber. Do you think there's actually a demand for something like that?
I think that there is. And in some ways, what you have here is a physical representation of some of what the ISPs were trying before the whole net neutrality thing blew up. Because when you talk about the requirement for very, very low latency, you're almost always talking about commercial traffic. For the vast majority of home users, it's not going to make any difference. The things that you're doing as a home user, whether it's video conferencing or watching a movie or anything else, simply isn't that sensitive to the kind of latency we're talking about. And so in a very real way, what we're talking about is splitting residential consumer level internet access off to fiber, and that would probably include small business as well, leaving the big corporate stuff to the microwave realm. That makes a ton of sense for everyone, and in some ways, it is similar to the whole internet versus I2 split that happened years ago. Taking things, dividing them up, keeping like traffic to like pipes tends to make everyone happier and everything faster.
You know, Chiebert, I was going back and forth on Twitter with a couple of fans about the story. It's interesting tech. What the researchers found out was that whenever you're delivering video, it's really not that time sensitive. Once the stream arrives, all you need is a lot of bandwidth and everyone's happy. But they discovered that the impatience factor of the internet, the thing that always makes us feel as if we're waiting, are typically very low bandwidth sites. It's mail, it's text, it's non-photos. It's just waiting for, you know, you're wondering why it's taking you those extra seconds to load up that site. They're figuring that a hybrid system would actually be able to fix that. So it's not just data getting there faster. It's taking care of the parts of the data that we need to have quickly in order to feel as if the service is running smoothly. But one of the points that was brought up was this won't work in an end-to-end encrypted world. If you can't find out what the traffic is and therefore prioritize this over the microwave link and this over the fiber link, you can't have a hybrid system, right? I mean, unless you broke the encryption or had the or trusted the hybrid device enough to allow the encryption to end there.
Excuse me, that's what MPLS does. And MPLS works just fine on encrypted data.
Explain MPLS. This was that softball toss to you, Chiebert. Give it to us.
Okay. Basically, it's a labeling system. It allows you to actually have routers and other types of internet devices give you feedback on things like congestion, latency, and so forth. So you can actually label your data streams as to whether they need a shortest path or a cheapest path, as an example. There's a lot of other things you can do with it. But MPLS has become the standard within the long-haul world of Tier 1 carriers. And it's perfectly capable of doing things like that. And you can actually use MPLS to, you know, split the stream. So I could easily see, say, the start of a stream going over the microwave so we can get it to the impatient people. And then as the buffer gets filled up, then switch it back to the fiber where it's going to be less expensive.
And the important thing here is you don't ever have to break the encryption. You don't actually have to see what's inside the packets as long as they've labeled it properly. Now, you could abuse the system. You could always label all your packets as fast as possible. But then, you know, in this hybrid system, you'd probably end up paying more.
Yeah, I would imagine you'd pay a lot more transit fees and things like that. Now, keep in mind, there are other reasons. There's a lot of talk about out of line of sight drone flying. There's actually a bunch of people going in for using drones flying along train tracks in order to automate and speed up the rail inspection process. Same thing for power line carriers. And one of the things that's happening is being able to have the signals repeated fast enough to be able to real-time control those drones. And that's something that this would quite a bit, you know, be really good for.
Right, right. Let me touch on one other thing that came up in this this Twitter stream. And I want to throw this over to you, Chiebert. Over to you, Curtis. People were saying, well, wait a minute. Wouldn't net neutrality kill this? Because you're talking about preferential treatment of data. But and this is one of the things that I think a lot of net neutrality opponents are really harking on. They're saying, well, no, you can't prioritize any data whatsoever. That's not actually what the net neutrality documents say. It calls for transparency. So you have to be able to explain why you're managing traffic in a certain way to the FCC when they ask. It's not a blunt instrument. It doesn't say that automatically anytime you prioritize one packet over another, you're in violation of net neutral principles. It just means that you have to be able to explain why you're doing them. Curtis, what's your take on this? I mean, there will be people who say, well, no. I mean, if you really believe in net neutral principles, then you shouldn't be able to prioritize traffic either over the wireless link or the fiber link.
Well, if you want to make everyone believe that net neutrality was a horrible idea and that all of the dire warnings about it are going to come true, then that very absolutist stand is the right one. This is a case where it is being prioritized, not even prioritized. I would say it is being differentiated on a rational basis. And as you say, there are advantages and disadvantages to both of these transmission mediums. So it's not really advantaging one over the other. It's simply putting one kind of traffic onto the medium that makes the most sense. And if you can do that, then everyone benefits. I think that if the FCC really does start eliminating the possibility for that, then net neutrality will turn out to be the horrible idea that all the ISPs have been telling us it was.
Gentlemen, let's go ahead and move on before we go further down this rat hole. I want to do one more enterprise bite, and specifically I want to talk about Google and Apple teaming up to defeat Skynet. That's how I'm labeling it. Now, we know that Apple and Google do not agree on much these days. They're fierce competitors. They're going back and forth. But they agreed enough to send a joint letter to President Obama asking him to reject any proposals that he might receive to create an encryption backdoor on mobile devices. This is a story that's been running. Now, of course, this comes out of law enforcement, specifically the FBI, saying it's becoming too difficult to track the bad guys, to figure out what they're doing, because device encryption is too strong, because we can't get around it, because we can't get the information that we need to be able to make them stop doing what they're doing. So they've made the reasonable request to Congress that there ought to be a backdoor for them to get into devices only when, and I quote, it's for the good of the country, you know, only to fight serious crimes. But Chiebert, here's the thing. You and I both know you can't just put a backdoor into encryption. Putting a backdoor into encryption basically means you've just made bunk encryption.
Yeah. It makes more sense to actually have it hit a switching center or some sort of repeater, decrypt, put something in that can be tapped with a court order, I might add, is my opinion, and then re-encrypt. That also allows you to reclock everything, resync everything, and so forth. So I think that's a middle ground. I do not believe we should put a backdoor in for the very reason that backdoors can be found.
But, I mean, okay, even taking your solution, so saying, all right, so the devices stay strong, but now we can put a man in the middle in the data center. After you go from device to tower, where it becomes unencrypted, we should be able to intercept whatever we need in order to do our job, to catch the bad guys. But there's another issue there, which is with so much of our information traveling over mobile devices, and with, again, yes, with so much of the enterprise hooked on mobile devices, is that really an option? Curtis, do we continue BYOD if there's even a remote chance that somewhere along the line our data is being tapped without our knowledge?
I think a lot of us would change our communications in significant ways if we felt that everything we were doing was open to casual reading. And let's get this straight. The opinion of many, many people is that if they're not doing anything wrong, then it is frankly none of the government's business. And the idea that their security, whether it be in banking, in making purchases over the internet, or simply communicating in confidence to friends, business associates, and family members, should be jeopardized simply because the government needs an easier path into someone else's communication doesn't make sense. BYOD is, I think, the smallest of the arguments against this. There is, frankly, the notion that all communications should be open to the government that underlies this. And I fear that I fundamentally agree with that, disagree with that premise.
But Curtis, by the same token, I mean, if you're not doing anything wrong, why would you be afraid of the government reading your data?
If I'm not doing anything wrong, then it's none of the government's damn business.
But, I mean, if there's nothing wrong, then there's no harm, no foul, right? Right, Chiebert?
Nah.
I'm trolling right now. I'm sorry. I have to throw that out there. Because, you know, it's funny. I was just having dinner with some very intelligent people the other night, all Jesuits. And there were at least three of them who said the same thing, which is, well, yeah, if you're not doing anything wrong, why do I care if the government can read my email? And I'm wondering, are we isolating ourselves by being hawks about this? Are we isolating ourselves by saying, no, there's something fundamentally wrong about that? There's something fundamentally wrong with a government agent, authorized or unauthorized, being able to read my information without a court order, without due process, just on a whim. And I don't know. There's something that really strikes me about that. I'm not sure why I'm so ticked off about the story, but I am. Chiebert, make me less mad.
No.
Okay. All right. That worked. That was. Thank you. I feel much better.
Well, Padre, let me troll you back.
Okay.
Using an example that you might very easily relate to. I think it would be very easy to consider something like doctor patient, lawyer client, or the relationship of a priest to a confessor to be a form of social encryption. We have declared that these are communications that are inviolate. But if what is being spoken about in those communications isn't actually breaking the law, then why would you care if the government was listening in?
I shouldn't, because I'm a good American, and I would never break any laws, and I'm hoping the NSA is no longer tapping my phones.
Nicely untrolled. Okay. Nicely untrolled.
All right, gentlemen, when we come back, we're going to be welcoming Allyn Malventano back onto the show from PC Perspective. I checked the schedule. He has not been on Twiet since episode 32, so it's been over 2 years since we've had him on. I am so happy to have him back. But before we do that, let's go ahead and thank the second sponsor of This Week in Enterprise Tech, and it's ZipRecruiter. Now, are you hiring? Well, if you are, you need to get the right person, because I don't know if you know this, but your business is only as good as the people that you hire. You need quality candidates, people who fit into your culture, people who know their business, who have the skills to make you succeed. But if you want those quality candidates, you can't just post to one site. You can't just ask one place to find it. You need to cast as wide a net as possible, which is why we are so happy to have ZipRecruiter as part of the Twiet Riot, because they get it. ZipRecruiter understands that posting your job in that one place isn't enough to find the quality candidates that you deserve. With ZipRecruiter.com, you post your job once and it gets placed on 100-plus job sites, and you get instantly matched on candidates from over 4 million resumes. You just post once, and within 24 hours, you can watch the qualified candidates start to roll into ZipRecruiter's easy-to-use interface. You get to make the right decisions about hiring in the least amount of time. I'll find out today why ZipRecruiter has been used by over 400,000 businesses. You can try ZipRecruiter today with a free 4-day trial and get your perfect candidate before they get snatched up by somebody else. Just go to ZipRecruiter.com/Twiet. That's ZipRecruiter.com/Twiet. And we thank ZipRecruiter for their support of This Week in Enterprise Tech. Gentlemen, I thank you very much for your patience. We get to have the meat of the episode, because we're welcoming back Mr. Allyn Malventano of PC Pers. Allyn, thank you very much for coming back onto the show.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
I think the last time we had you in, you were showing off some incredible data center that you had built for the Navy that you weren't supposed to show us pictures of, but you did anyways.
No, I was allowed to show pictures. When it didn't have anything stored on it, which is when those pictures were taken.
Now they do. Probably.
Yeah, now you can't take pictures anymore. It was That was a big SAN just put together to do forensic imaging of like hard drives of systems that have been compromised.
Isn't that a little strange that you could take a picture of it then because it was brand new, but now you can't take pictures of it, even though the pictures wouldn't actually show you anything? I mean,
well, now, I can't even get in that building. So
okay, good. Yes.
Because I'm retired.
I understand.
So, you know.
Oh, but, and by the way, since you were last on, yes, A, you retired. B, something else big had happened. I think, you got married and had a kid.
Didn't have a kid.
I thought you had a kid.
Don't do that to me yet.
Oh, Ryan had a kid. Sorry. No, that was
Ryan is the one that's about to have a kid.
Okay. Yeah. Read out. I thought I was announcing something to you.
And I moved across the country.
That's right. Oh, congratulations on that. I saw pictures of your new house. Quite nice.
Yeah, thank you.
All right. Still working on it. We've brought you on to talk about a little story that's been circulating on the internet. And actually, we were going to cover it last week, but unfortunately, Venom happened. So we had to cover Venom. But it's got a lot of people really freaked out. And let's just get all the facts straight. Now, this was a story that came out of a presentation done by Alvin Cox, who was a senior staff member at Seagate. Now, he wasn't commenting on behalf of Seagate. He was the chairperson of some panel that had a really long technical name that was talking about data retention within SSDs. Now, the gist of it was, if you environmentally stress SSDs, they could lose data if unpowered. Could you run us through this? Why did this become such a hysteria?
Well, okay. So, first of all, the quick thing to clear up is that all SSDs will eventually lose data when they're unpowered.
Right.
But it'll take like years for most typical, you know, kind of purposes, right?
Well, I think that is actually the part that freaks some people out, because some people didn't realize that was the case. An SSD is not a USB flash drive, and it slowly loses its charge over time. And so if you don't power it up within a couple of years, it will eventually reach a state which you can't tell if it was one or zero.
Well, it's funny you say that. Like, SD cards and USB flash drives, they also have flash memory in them.
Right,
They'll still do the same thing, right? But the catch there is they just haven't been cycled nearly as much.
Right.
Right? So their flash memory is still in much better shape. What made this whole thing start circulating, because that presentation is actually like a year or two old, I think. It's a while ago. And then it got picked back up in response to something that got posted on the CoreLogic blog, which these are guys that do like forensic data analysis, which I actually saw that posting like almost right away, because it's still one of those things I was just following because I used to do that full time in the Navy. That used to be my thing. So I saw that story and I was like, yeah. So the claims in the story were, hey, we had an SSD in for forensic analysis, and we took the image and then we put it on a shelf for a few months. And then we went to go look at it again, and we couldn't read from it. And it had only been, you know, I'm not sure if it was a few months, or they were claiming as short as a week. I think in that one case, though, just from reading that versus what I actually know, I think they just had a bad SSD. Just one that, you know, it had some defects to it. Maybe there was a weak solder joint on some of the flash or something like that. Who knows? Just something to cause errors, right? But it is very, very atypical. Like, it's just... Don't expect your SSD to just lose data over a week. Now, actually looking at the presentation, I'm not sure if you have that particular slide in question that came up.
Alex will find it. He's very good at that.
Yeah, so there's this JDEC presentation that was done, you know, a couple of years back. And it basically has the chart that not only was the speaker from Seagate, but the chart is actually sourced from Intel data. I've actually seen this chart before, just from stuff that I've been to in the past, presentations given to me by Intel. And all it is it just shows the temperature that you're operating the SSD at. And not only are you operating it at the temperature, you're doing that for its entire lifetime worth of usage. Okay, so in other words, if the SSD is rated at writing, you know, say 10 or 20 gigabytes per day for 5 years, you have to have written that total amount to it. And only after you've written that total amount to it do any of the numbers on that chart apply. First of all, right? So it's basically you are at the maximum lifetime usage of all of the flash memory.
Right. So we're talking about a really tired SSD. This has been an SSD that you have written a ton of data to.
Yeah. Yeah. You have basically spent all of the usability of that flash memory at that point, right? And then the JEDEC ratings, like the way that their required ratings system is supposed to work, is we expect a client-based SSD to be able to hold that data at that point all the way at the end of life. Then you turn the system off, you take the SSD, you put it on a shelf for a year, you should be able to read everything back just fine. Okay, so that's their typical kind of things. And there's actually a little green highlighted cell in that chart that shows, you know, where they came up with that number, like where that number fits in with that chart, right? And there's a couple of things that are interesting here that people may not understand or recognize. And that's flash memory holds its data, holds its bits by just electrons sitting inside of an insulated cavity, right? It's like it's almost like a container that they can't leak out of, right? And for with the way that silicon works, the hotter it is, temperature-wise, the easier it is to conduct what should be an insulator, what should be like stopping electrons from moving. They will tend to flow through that insulator. So basically, for an SSD that's stored and it's powered down, it will leak its electrons and it will lose its charge faster if it's hotter. Okay, so if you're going to store SSDs on a shelf somewhere, you know, good idea. Put it in, colder is better, basically, right? I wouldn't go as far as your freezer, but you could legitimately, you know, put these things in your fridge, like, you know, your grandmother used to do with old batteries, I guess, that kind of thing, right? And it would actually help. Okay, the colder is better for storage. Now, there's the other thing that's confuses a lot of people about that chart in particular, is there's also an active temperature, and that is, again, this is over the entire lifetime, right? So if you had an SSD, you were using it for several years, at any of those specific temperatures on there, and I know they're all on C and we're not overseas, so it might be a little bit tricky to recognize, but basically the left side of on the active temperature there is like 70 degrees or so. The right side's like 130 degrees or so Fahrenheit. If you were using the SSD through its entire lifetime at a very cold temperature, the SSD would have to work harder in order to change the voltages in those cells. In other words, it would wear out the flash more aggressively. Like it would beat up those insulators more if it had to spend its whole life at a very cold temperature as compared to if it spent its whole life at a very warm temperature. So it's actually better to operate the SSD warm, like the warmer the better. But then when it comes to cold storage, so to speak, like when it's powered down and you're putting it on a shelf, then you want it cold, right? So it's kind of a weird thing to understand there. But if you take that table all the way to the extreme and you look at the upper left corner, yes, you can get to a week. But you have to have operated the SSD basically with like a liquid cooling setup on the flash chips, right? To keep them at room temperature, which is basically what 25C is. And you have to have keep it that cool while it's operating for its whole lifetime. And then once you took it out of your machine, you have to put it in a room that's 130 degrees Fahrenheit. You know, for a week.
Allyn, that's the thing about this story. I got this forwarded to me so many times by people who are actually pretty tech savvy who were saying, should I be worried about my SSD? I got a brand new Samsung. I got a brand new Kingston. I don't want, you know, I shut this computer down when I go on vacation over the summer. I'm going to be gone for a month. Should I be worried that my data will be there when I get back? The funny thing was, if you actually look at the report, if you read the report, this wasn't a sensationalist report. They weren't saying this is going to happen to you. They were saying, oh, here's an interesting phenomenon that happens with SSDs at the end of their life. And it just
They actually used that chart in order to accelerate the testing.
Right. They were trying to make it fail.
No, that not only that, but if they understand how the flash responds in certain directions, like temperature-wise and time-wise and stuff like that, then they don't want to, like SSDs wouldn't come out for forever if they had to test them before they, you know, before they started producing them. Like it would take a year, several years to test them, right? So that whole presentation was like ways to, you know, here's these issues, here's how the SSD, here's how flash memory responds to these different kinds of temperatures and things over life. And then later on in the presentation, it goes into like ways to accelerate that process, right? So that's how Intel's able to launch, you know, any given SSD and say, okay, we expect the lifetime to be this. They couldn't even come up with that rating unless they had some way to speed up that process, right?
Yeah, and it's like, wait a minute. So Intel says this is going to last 10 years. Did they actually test this for 10 years? Like, no, of course. They figured out a way to make it fail prematurely. And then they extrapolated the data from that to say, well, in real world conditions, it would last X long. But so let's set the record straight. At least for consumer drives, if you're reading this report and if you're listening to this podcast right now, don't worry. They were talking about A, drives at the end of their lifespan. So these, you have none of these. Unless you bought one of the very first SSDs and you have been using it constantly, you probably don't have an SSD that is worn out to the point where it would apply to this. B, you'd have to put it in an abnormally hot place. You're deliberately trying to make this thing fail. And then three, you'd have to power it off.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, there is another piece that I do want to talk about, because this actually was interesting information out of that same presentation, and that is you could make enterprise-class drives fail more quickly than consumer-class drives. Why is that?
It's not that they can fail more quickly. It's that they're rated less aggressively, like less conservatively. In other words, enterprise, like the firmware in an enterprise SSD is just going to be optimized completely different, designed to handle different kinds of workloads, designed to handle them in such a way that it might actually beat up the flash memory faster, right? So it does things to be able to respond to a specific kind of IO request faster for an enterprise workload and more consistently over time, right? Whereas a consumer drive, if you beat it up with that same kind of workload, it would basically be on its knees within a matter of an hour,
right?
Enterprise SSDs have to be able to just do this 24/7 for their whole lifetime. So that kind of optimization tends to beat up the flash faster. So the rating for those is a little bit more lax, kind of, in that, you know, they only rate them, the requirement is 3 months data retention. But in reality, for enterprise, you're not...
They'd never be powered off. If it's an enterprise drive in its proper application, it wouldn't be powered off until it was time to swap it out.
Ever. Right, exactly. Yeah, you're using it until it's dead, basically. And that actually brings up another interesting point, is that Intel's enterprise SSDs, this is the only one that I can say with confirmation, is their SSDs, they design their firmwares in such a way that even if the slightest thing kind of hiccups with the firmware or just some piece of data doesn't look right, not just like flash going on its way out, but basically anything in the whole chain, those drives go into what's called an assert mode. They just brick themselves.
Right.
Because
don't use me anymore.
You just don't want, if you're in an enterprise environment, you don't want to sit there with some kind of intermittent issue with an SSD and have to try to hunt for it, right? You just want it to be done so you can put the spare in and just, you know, go on with your day and go troubleshoot and, you know, replace the paper in the printer or something.
Yeah. That kind of thing. If I lose a bit on my consumer drive, maybe I just lost a picture of a puppy. If I lose a bit on an enterprise drive, I might have just bricked a database that I really, really need. So
exactly.
That's the difference. All right. So don't panic. Can we officially say that Allyn Malventano, our storage guru, says, forget about it?
Yeah, pretty much forget about it. And like one last example, like even the Samsung A40 Evos, which by the way, are now fixed, thank goodness, as far as it looks, with the last firmware that came out, they had an issue where cell voltages drift slightly over time, and like that firmware just wasn't handling it correctly. And even then, of all the reports of people that were up in arms saying, hey, it's reading slowly and I want this fixed and everything, yes, they were all reading slow over time. In other words, data you hadn't touched in a matter of a few months, but they weren't like not reading the data.
Right.
I hadn't seen a single person say, oh, I couldn't read this file, right? It was still readable, just like that particular thing just kind of had a quirk to it where it was kicking an error correction a little sooner than it should have.
Right. Now, I actually have a shelf. I have about a dozen 840 Evos that I pulled from machines because they just became unbearably slow. I have not yet run the firmware correction, but I'm pretty sure that once I run it, I've got at least 75% of their lifespan left. So those will go back into machines. By the way, if you want to find out about that, you got to go over to PC PERS because they did a great write-up on the fix, why it works, and why you should run it on every 840 Evo you have.
Yeah. Yep.
Now, we will come back in just a bit, Allyn, but first, I wanted you to take a look at a video that we shot at Interop. We stopped by the SanDisk booth, and they showed us why the next enterprise drive you have might not look like the one you have right now.
I'm Father Robert Ballecer with TWiT TV here at Interop Las Vegas 2015. I'm at the SanDisk booth because I wanted to give something for those storage, crazy, fast, hungry people that are in our audience. This is the InfiniFlash. And to explain what the InfiniFlash is, we've got Fritz Krueger, who's going to, run us through the finer points of this product. Fritz, thank you very much for talking to us. What is this?
This is 512 terabytes, half a petabyte, and a 3U, all flash, at less than $1 a gigabyte.
That's pretty succinct, and it's also, what? Okay, so half a petabyte, using these cards, this is a SAS backplane, so if you've got SAS in your network, this will work just fine. And why did you decide to go with this format? This is a very interesting, I've never seen before, proprietary format.
So there are 64 of these cards. Each of these is 8 terabytes. We designed this card from the ground up as SanDisk to get flash from the SanDisk foundry to the end customer at the cheapest way possible. So we looked at every step that flash goes through on its way from that foundry to an end customer, and we said, why are we doing that? What's the way that we can reduce that cost? If we look at a traditional 2.5-inch SSD, right, something that looks like this, it's in a hard drive form factor, fundamentally. Has a lot of very specialized miniaturized components, these strange flex connectors, et cetera. This is really what an SSD wants to look like. And so it's the lowest possible cost.
This is the part that really blew me away when you were explaining this to me before we started rolling camera, and that is when you think about what's actually in an SSD, even an enterprise level SSD, it does. It looks something like this. You've got memory chips on cards that are attached to a controller via a ribbon cable, and you've got to micronize everything. Is that even a word? In order to make it fit properly. Now, you were explaining how these capacitors, and you need capacitors in an SSD because if you lose power, you want it to be able to complete the write, otherwise you're going to corrupt everything. These capacitors are far more expensive and far less reliable because they have to be so small versus this, where you've got much larger capacitors in a larger format, and you don't have to worry about the ribbon cable. So you really have just made this flat. You've given it the best possible shape and put it into a chassis.
Absolutely. And it's far more than just the capacitors. That's an excellent example, though. And we've really taken it all the way through, including manufacturing processes. These cards are actually manufactured directly in this chassis. There are no separate test rigs. All of these things require separate test rigs.
All right, now we've got to give our audience the specs because they got to geek out over these specs. Tell me, IOPS, speed, give me the whole rundown.
So flat out, it's about 1.2 million IOPS for the box. If you constrain your latency, we're at 5 nines latency of less than a millisecond at about 800K IOPS.
Now, this is basically designed for anyone who needs big data, anyone who needs a lot of data to move around very quickly. And that might be transactional information. It might be video. Who knows? But this is the kind of unit that you could see bottom of rack, basically driving a data center. Tell me, pricing and availability.
So, again, less than $1 a gigabyte. Available right now. We are shipping.
Fritz, if they wanted to go and find out more about the InfiniFlash series, or maybe find a place where they can see for themselves if it might be for their data center, where can they go?
Go to sandisk.com. Right on the front page, you should be able to click directly onto InfiniFlash.
Fritz Krueger, thank you very much for spending time with us again. I'm Father Robert Ballecer, and if you want to go fast, maybe you need to go InfiniFast.
You know, Chiebert, I remember when there was a similar system at Interop was 5 years ago from IO Fusion, which was bought by SanDisk, by the way. It was something like a $500,000 solution. This at $1 a gigabyte is for 500 terabytes, you'd be looking at like $5,000. That's actually not bad.
No, actually it isn't. And what was that guy's number?
No, he's sending hold it on, to me on. First.
Does that math work out? I think that's still $500,000. Roughly.
Thousand gigabytes per terabyte. Okay, no, you're right. Okay.
Yeah. But here's the thing. The thing you were looking at a few years ago, I seriously doubt was half a petabyte.
No. That was maybe a terabyte.
Those are some pretty impressive specs. 800,000 IOPS at I think he said 5 nines latency. So basically, that's like 99.999% of the IOs are all going to be less than a millisecond. So you're really kind of beating the thing up, and for very, very few IOs.
I asked him for a review chassis, and I don't think I'm probably not going to get it. I don't.
You'd be lucky to get one card.
Well, yeah, T-Bert, really quickly, I do want to bring this in because Alex and I were having a conversation off camera during that video. He was saying, look, he didn't buy into the hype. He knew the hype was wrong, but there is still a large part of the population that thinks that if you pull an SSD out of a system, it's more secure for archival storage than a hard drive because there's nothing moving in it. And you know better, right? I mean, you understand that if you want archival storage, you actually need to do archival storage.
Yeah. Okay, yeah.
Hold on. Cheaper than Allyn.
Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
Okay, so, the reality is, spinning disk, SSDs, no matter what you do, worst case, even if you manage to take a hammer to an SSD, you can still desolder the individual cells and still read portions of that data. So one, no, you can recover lots of different things. In fact, drive savers and people like that are actually starting to offer services where they will actually unsolder the storage cells and move it onto an operational card and then read your data. If you want to store long-term anything, you really ought to be using something that was designed for that. And, that's one of the reason why I pinged Horst Schellong from HITS to say, dude, we got to have you on the show because Blu-ray is designed to be archival. And even though we're probably not going to have a drive in 100 years, the Blu-rays themselves, because it's sandwiched polycarbonate, is supposed to last 100 years. And so far, none of my Blu-rays that I've been using for my underwater observatory have failed, which is pretty awesome. And by the way, chat room, yes, I'm using a salt mine in Utah to store my offsite storage so that we'll always have this data.
I use the secret salt mine under the Vatican archives in Rome. That's just my thing. Allyn, did you want to throw something on top of that?
Yeah, but I was going to go as far as we actually had a conversation like this about on Twitch a few months back, I think, with Patrick Norton. And that is, SSDs are probably not the best thing for archival storage. Mm-hmm. You should probably be using, like, if anything, I mean, you could go Blu-ray, yes, but if you want to be able to, like, access it a little bit more random and access larger amounts of data, just use a hard drive, right? Hard drives can store data for very long periods of time. Like, you're really, your issues there are more other kinds of failures. Like, it's a mechanical device, obviously. Right. So if you leave a mechanical device sitting on a shelf for 100 years, the bearings might not work anymore, right? It might not spin because the oil might have evaporated off out of the bearing or something like that. So obviously there's some other things you have to take care of and, make sure you're storing it in a proper environment and everything. If you want to really do kind of like put it on a shelf, archive, and just forget about it for a very long time. But yeah, as far as like, at least with the hard drive, those magnetic domains are not very likely to just like forget.
Right.
Right. That tends to not happen. You're not going to get leaking like magnetic fields or anything like that, like you would get with flash memory, where you're actually getting leaking electrons out of cells over time.
I want to throw to Curtis really quickly here. Curtis, how big of a topic is archival storage on Information Week Radio? Is it a requested topic, or are we to the point where we do near-term storage, maybe mid-term storage, but we don't really worry about archival storage as much as we used to?
Well, there's been a lull in worrying about archival storage, but I tell you what, I think it's going to heat up again. And while I hate to overuse the phrase, the thing that's going to heat it up is the Internet of Things, because I am hearing more and more people talk about this flood of information that's coming in. Now, they know that they can't keep all of the data that floods in from these sensors and control systems out on small devices in hot storage. They just don't have the money to do that. But they're deathly afraid that if they don't keep it at all, there's going to be the opportunity for meaningful analysis later on that is lost. What's the answer? Archival storage. This cold storage field is something that more and more people are going to be talking about. We're already hearing those conversations starting. So I think that Twyatt is a little bit ahead of the curve, but the curve is coming.
Curve is coming, indeed. Allyn, I'm sorry, I got a note here. Did you want to throw something on top of that?
You know, I used to work there.
Oh, wait, what?
You didn't know that?
No.
What do you think I was doing in San Antonio?
Oh, really? Oh, okay.
Anyway, so actually, Curtis hit the nail on the head there, though. I could definitely say that. There's a lot of times you're trying to, you know, follow a trail of breadcrumbs that you just figured out that there's some really bad stuff going on somewhere in the world, and you're trying to put pieces together. And if you don't have the information to kind of go back and be able to look at, you know, that's pretty much just stops you in your tracks, and you can't really do anything else.
Right.
That's not to say I necessarily agree with, you know, all the things that are changing right now. And I think they're changing for pretty good reason, because sometimes the rules just need to be kind of straightened out a little bit every so often. But yeah, I was definitely on the other side of that. And I could say, you know, sometimes that stuff does come in handy. And to put everybody's fears at rest, by the way, from someone that used to actually work there, no, we don't want to read your emails. We don't, like, that's, first of all, we're not allowed to. There's rules. Second of all, there's people that audit what we look at and say, hey, why were you looking at so-and-so's whatever, right? Because we're just not supposed to do that. That's just things you're not supposed to do. I mean, there's obviously a standpoint, for, you know, that can say, hey, I don't think you should have those things at all in the first place. And that's also completely valid and, you know, that's subject of debate all over the place right now. But yeah, trust me, we were too busy actually trying to look for bad guys. Like, we don't, you know.
You know, that actually could be the show title. Malventano doesn't read your email.
No, yeah. No, I don't. Yeah. I don't want to either.
Yeah. Allyn, I did want to get to one last thing about Raid 5, about whether or not it was doomed and we should never, ever use it again. Unfortunately, we've ran out of time, so I'm going to have to bring you back into a future episode. Are you okay with that?
Oh, darn.
I know. It's always a pleasure to have you on, Allyn. Now, folks, that's right. You have used up another hour. Listen to the best dang enterprise podcast in the universe. That's according to 9 out of 10 failed SSDs. I want to thank my panelists for being part of this show, starting with Allyn Malventano. You can catch him at PC Perspective. Allyn, you're a prince. You're a gem. It's always fantastic whenever you come onto the show. I'm not going to wait another 120 episodes or 110 episodes for you to come on. We're going to have you back on really quickly. But could you please tell our audience where they can find you, where they can find your work?
I am at PCPer.com. I'm on Twitter at Malventano, although I don't use it as much as I'd like to because I'm usually busy testing stuff.
Yes, which is what we want. We want to see you blow stuff up and tear things apart. And remember, folks, be afraid because he could have read your emails, but he didn't because he's a good guy. He's a good guy. I also want to thank my co-host, starting with Mr. Brian Chee, again, the director of the Advanced Network Computing Laboratory in Honolulu, Hawaii. Cheebert, I'm going to see you in a couple of days. What are we going to do?
I don't know. Play with drones.
Drones. Eat. Definitely drones.
Eat.
You got that map of all the places where we're not allowed to fly on that island, but that means all those other places we are allowed to fly.
Yeah, pretty much. And if you really want to fly in some of the shoreline areas, I'll go see if I can get my name added to the COA that we have for shoreline mapping.
Let's do that. Yes. Oh, and thank you. Thank you, Gromit. That's always nice to see you. Also, thanks to Mr. Curtis Franklin, again from Information Week Radio. Curtis, what can the Twyatt Right look forward to in Information Week Radio this week?
Well, Padre, next week we're going to be back in the saddle with Information Week Radio. We're also coming back with Interop Radio. And in the pages, if you will, of InformationWeek.com, I'll be back with the first product evaluation to be seen out of Information Week in quite a while, looking at a scanner for your backpack. So we're getting back in the reviews business. Hope everyone will come over and check that out.
Fantastic. I also want to thank you. That's right, our loyal audience, the listener, the viewer, the person who downloads our show each and every single week. We wouldn't be able to do this. We wouldn't be able to geek out with people like Cheebert, like Curtis, like Allyn, if it weren't for your support. So we want to make it easy for you to get This Week in Enterprise Tech into the device of your choice. Just go to our show page at twit.tv/twiet. There you'll find all of our back episodes and our show notes, along with a drop-down menu so you can subscribe. That's right. You can get the audio version into your iPhone. You can get the video version into your Android tablet. You can get the high-definition version into your Mac, your PC, your desktop, your laptop, whatever it is. We want to give you a format that works for you because, well, you are the Twiet Riot. Also, don't forget that we do this show live every week, Fridays at 1 o'clock p.m. Pacific time, 1 o'clock-ish. It depends on how far back we get pushed. But go ahead and join us at live.twit.tv so you can see how the sausage is made. And as long as you're watching the sausage, jump into our chat room at irc.twit.tv. There you'll be able to communicate with me during the show, actually with all of our hosts. I have a little screen right up there that has all of you speaking at any given time. It's kind of unnerving, but I like it because chat room, you know, I love you. Finally, I want to thank everyone here in the Twit Brick House who makes this show possible. Of course, to Lisa, to Leo, to Carson, my super producer. And today, to my super special TD, Anel3. That's right, Alex Gumpel, who's reminding us that we're running out of time. Alex, could you please tell people... He's shaking his head. No, it's...
You could find me hurrying Padre up on know-how.
Yes, you'll find him harassing me on the know-how set. Until next time, I'm Father Robert Ballecer, just reminding you that if you want to know what's going on in the Enterprise, just keep Twiet.